start this class. This is lecture 19. Hopefully that whatever is in YouTube will be given the numbers. So we have taken the process so you can view it serially. Then when it comes to the gyroscope, these are the topics that we are going to cover. We have defined what is a gyroscope, especially a simplified gyroscope. Then the uses of the gyroscope, because as an engineer we are interested in exploiting a phenomenon, not, you know, just as a physicist observing the phenomena and learning about it. We should be also exploiting it. That is the important thing. So if you look at the phenomena of laser, if you take laser, it is a phenomena. So light simulated emission of radiation, that's a phenomena observed by physicists. Later it was used for reading the memory in a non-contact way. So the magnetic tapes were replaced by CD players. Then from CD to your DVD, etc., and that is being replaced by flash memory. So things evolve and change. The same laser with high intensity is now used for cutting. So it is, imagine some 18 millimeter thick steel rod can be cut using the laser. So exploitation of those phenomena is our interest. So for exploiting, you should know in depth what is the phenomena itself. The basic principles are should be known. So the uses of gyroscope, the phenomena of gyroscopic effect is used in three different ways. One is the inertial navigation, that is like a compass. A magnetic compass is the one which always shows the north and the south, so that can be used to know the directions. Next, it can be used as a rate gyro for measuring the angular velocity, okay? So angular rotation can be found out, the angular velocity can be found out by integrating. You can find out the angular velocity. Then it can be used as a stabilizer as well. So these principles, these are the uses that we are going to discuss. Then in addition, we will discuss about the spinning top. So the interesting toy, how it really works. Then we will discuss the large spinning top on which we are all living, that is the earth. So what is the phenomena, how the precession of the earth is taking place. So that we will discuss. Now we will take up, you know, reviewing the how it is used as an inertial compass. So first application of the gyroscope is it is used as an inertial navigation. That means we need to know the direction where you cannot use any other method. The direction can be shown by using the principle of the conservation of the angular momentum, which says that in the absence of external torque. So if the external torque is zero, that means the no torque is acting on a rotating wheel. So I take, for example, a rotating wheel like this. It is spinning. So its angular momentum vector like this will be in this direction. That is given by I omega. In the absence of external torque, that is a zero torque is there, then the momentum vector or angular momentum is conserved. Conserved means it's both direction and magnitude will be conserved. So if I want a compass which will indicate all the same direction irrespective of the rotation of the frame on which it is mounted, I should ensure that the torque is not transmitted. It should be on a torque-free suspension. Okay? Torque-free suspension. We need a torque-free suspension. We know that a revolute joint cannot transmit torque through it. So you can use a revolute joint for this purpose. So we will use a revolute joint here for suspending this. So any torque in this direction, that is in the, if as a rotation, as a vector, any torque in this direction cannot be transmitted because you have a revolute joint over here. Then this, you can think of another the frame like this. So you can think of another pair of revolute joint in the perpendicular direction. So the torque along this direction cannot be transmitted. So we think of another frame like this on which it is mounted, you know, where it will be that the torque, the bearing will be in the perpendicular direction. So you have a pair of bearings in three perpendicular directions. So in all the three perpendicular directions, torque cannot be transmitted, means that this wheel cannot be disturbed even if it is on mounted on a frame that turns, no torque will be transmitted. So when you start that spinning, you keep the direction, one direction, it will maintain irrespective of the motion. So such mounting is called gimbal. So gimbal mounting, this term you could have come across in a drone. So you have now drones. Drones carries a camera. So the camera is supposed to, you know, even if a drone change, suppose it has to look at the same thing, it is mounted on a gimbal. So they use a term that cameras are mounted on a gimbal. So gimbal is a torque-free suspension. So it, you can make this spinning wheel to in point out the same direction irrespective of the rotation of the frame on which it is mounted. Then you have to use the principle of conservation of angular momentum. So you make the external torque to zero, then it will maintain. So this is for indicating the direction. So that is you called the inertial navigation. So I will show you the PowerPoint also where better pictures will be available, so you can see that. Any doubt? So you have to choose a very precise bearing if you want to have a quality gyros. So the bearings are normally made of a ruby. So this makes this gyro is quite expensive. Okay. Now the second use of a gyro is a rate gyro. Rate gyro means it is going to deduct rate of change of the angle. Here it will measure this rate of change of this angle. So that is why it is called a rate gyro. You know that gyroscopic moment or the torque that you apply, the torque of the gyroscopic thing is given by I omega omega p. So this omega stands for the spinning angular velocity. You can even suffix, add a suffix of s. This angular velocity is the velocity of the precession. So we have derived it, how this term comes. Now we have to look at it. We are interested in measuring very slow motions. That is what the rate gyro is. I want to measure omega p, that is the precession of, or I want to measure very slow motions of a spacecraft. So I want to measure omega p. I can use this equation and write that omega p is equal to t by I omega s. So a slow motion, the angular motion, that is d theta by dt, that is the angular velocity itself, can be measured by t by I omega s. So I need to measure the torque that is applied on the gyro. If I know the angular, the moment of inertia of the wheel about the axis which is spinning, and if I know the angular velocity of the spin, I can find out what is omega p. So here what we do is we take a rotor, there is the rotor, then you make it to spin at angular velocity omega s. This is I. Then you don't use the difference between the previous version, that is the initial navigation, and this is, here you don't use a torque free suspension. You make the torque to act on it. Let there be a torque acting on it. So it is in the bearings because it has to allow the spin of the rotor, but this is firmly mounted on the frame. No gimbal mounting in this case. It is the rotor mounted on the bearings so that it can spin about this axis, but it is mounted on the frame, on the vehicle for which you have to measure the angular rotations. So if this is mounted on a, for example, a spacecraft or on your aeroplane, this, when the aeroplane turns by a small angular rotation, whatever it is, when it turns, this will also, the aeroplane also will make the wheel to turn, the axis of the wheel to turn. So for example, this is my, the I omega angular momentum vector like this, then when the aeroplane turns, that will also turn. If the aeroplane turns in this direction, that will also turn. So in this case, the axis of the spinning gyro is turned. It is made to change. So when there is a change, you can say there is a change in the angular momentum vector. The rate of change of the angular momentum vector is equal to the torque applied on it. Okay, so you take the spinning wheel, this is having, it is spinning, then its angular momentum vector is in this direction. By any chance you try to turn it, you must apply a torque on it. That torque is applied by what? The torque is applied by the vehicle itself, that comes to this gyroscope by the two bearings, because that is the only connection between the frame and this. So if I draw the free body diagram of the gyro, the forces that causes the torque comes from the bearings. So if I remove this and replace that with the appropriate reaction, that could be a force acting on it like this. So you have a bearing and it is mounted attached to the frame. As the whole vehicle changes, the gyroscope also turns. That means it is possible only if you apply an external torque in the direction at which the angular momentum vector is changed. So there must be a force acting on that. So this force into this distance d is equal to the torque that is applied on it. So from this equation, if I want to measure the precession rate, I should know what is the torque, I should know the angular velocity at which it is spinning, I should know what is I. So I is probably the constant. Then omega, spinning speed of this wheel, I can easily find out by putting a sensor, a tachometer, I can easily measure it. What I need to know or I have to measure is the torque that is applied to cause this precession. That torque is acting through the bearings. So what I do is I put a sensor here. Not just a bearing, it should be mounted on a sensor to measure the force that is acting on it. So if I measure the force that is applied on the wheel using a sensor, that force into the distance is going to be a constant, then I will be able to find out what is the torque. I know these quantities, I can compute what is omega p. This is the principle of a rate gyro. Okay, so rate gyro means it is going to measure the angular velocity, the rate of change of the angular displacement. So it has to measure the omega p, that will be given by torque divided by this. I measure the torque by putting a sensor, four sensors on the bearings. I know I, that is going to be a constant, and another is omega s, that is the spinning, the angular velocity of this wheel, I can put a sensor and measure. So this is like this. It is not on a torque-free suspension. It is mounted in such a way that torque can be exerted on it so that it can change in direction. You have any doubt? This is amazing. Precession or precision at which it is made, or the quality which it is made, we have discussed last class, you know, it can sense a very, very small rotation. So in 1960s, Apollo mission program had a rate gyro which can measure a precession rate of something like, you know, one, we know what is one RPM. One revolution per minute, we know that itself is a slow speed, but the rate gyros that were used in Apollo missions could detect the precession rate of one rotation per 30,000 years. So amazing piece that they have made, so that even a very, very, very small variation they can detect. So one rotation in 30,000 years is the precision of the rate gyro that was used in Apollo mission. So industrial use of the phenomena, that is a gyroscope. Okay, so as I told you, you know, this was made in a special laboratory attached to the MIT. So where NASA people and all these people were interacting, a team of scientists have developed this. Without this, it was not possible to make it. So another path-breaking development associated with the Apollo mission is the integrated chip, in the electronics integrated chip. Earlier they were using PCBs, they are not reliable. So they had to make a reliable small circuit. So that was the integrated chip. It was used, and then that has made possible. Now today you have the handheld devices which are has the most computing power than computers used for this mission. That is possible because of the technology of the integrated chip. From integrated chip to very large scale integration, large scale integration, then very large scale integration made possible to shrink your chip. Okay, any doubt?
How is the torque?
You measure the force. So force into the distance is the torque.
Yes sir, but now torque is being applied. So in this particular case, the torque will be going into the bearing.
Yeah, you see, I'll take this, the torque, this is the angular momentum vector. So what will happen is, the torque is going in this, so what will happen is this will rotate like this. The precession will be like this. So in other words, if my vehicle on which it is mounted turns like this, you know, the torque also will be applied. So this angular momentum vector, it is applied a torque, so it will process in this direction. Yeah, it is fixed to the vehicle, means it will take the new orientation, it goes along with that. Earlier occasion, it will try to indicate the same direction. Now it has to move along with the vehicle. If my vehicle turns like this, it also should move. Yeah.
The vehicle should be turning like this.
No. Vehicle, when it presses, it will be like this only. See, suppose I mounted this, if the whole thing is turned like this, in this orientation, it will process like this. So that means I should have applied the torque in this way. The forces will act in this. Don't think that for applying the force, the vehicle should move like that. It is not. Okay? So I will also discuss, you know, some similarities between the centripetal force and the gyroscopic torque. Okay? So that, you know, that is why this is a highly non-intuitive phenomenon. Okay, you cannot say that by intuition this will go like this. It will behave in a different way. But it with obeying the basic principles of mechanics, not violating it. Okay, so when a force is like this, acting like this, I should say that because of this torque, the direction of this angular momentum vector should have changed like this. So that means the precession would have taken like this. So the vehicle also would have rotated in this direction. Vehicle turns like this, but the torque is applied in a perpendicular direction. One of the important thing is the I omega and omega p is, you have the three vectors. Torque is a vector. I omega s is the angular momentum vector. Omega p is the precession, angular velocity vector. All the three vectors are in a perpendicular direction. Okay, they are, none of them are in the same direction. They are in the perpendicular direction. Okay, I feel that you have to wait a little more to see the videos, and again you see, if you are not convinced with that, we can discuss. Okay, lot more other things are there. Now this is about the rate gyro, the use of this. Any other questions? Now the another use of this is as a stabilizer. If you have a large spinning wheel, or if you have a wheel which has a large angular momentum, to turn that vessel you have to apply a greater torque. So in ships, for example, what we do is we mount a gyro which will be running at a speed, sufficiently higher speed, so that when the waves comes and try to tilt it, it will not tilt easily. So you have to have a sufficient torque to change its direction. Then only it will turn. So it will have a stabilizing effect. Or in other words, it is said that a spinning thing has high stability. Okay? If I have a gun, you fire the gun, a bullet comes out. If the bullet comes out, it has a linear velocity, or it has a linear momentum. If there is a wind blow like that, it will take this out. there's a force is acting like that, it will change its direction. Wind blow applies a force that will change its direction. So instead of a gun, if you use a rifle, the difference between a gun and a rifle is a gun will have a straight hole so that when the bullet is fired, it will just simply have a linear velocity alone. A rifle will have a groove inside, so the bullet will be turned in addition to the linear velocity, and angular rotation is also important to it. So it will have a greater stabilized effect because you have to apply an external torque to do it. The torque will come only if there is a wind blow, which is the net force is acting away from the center. That will, if you spin, give a greater spin, it will not be, the direction cannot be changed. So it will go and hit the target with more accuracy than with the ordinary gun. So rifle is the effect. And you have stabilizers in ships. So we will see a greater detail of the stabilization effect in the next class. Okay. Now we will see the other aspects of it, that is how a spinning top is a gyro, how earth itself is a gyro. We'll use, before that we will just take a small demo of this spinning top. Okay, so what happens with the spinning top? I take this, the base, this is not rotating, spinning, I keep it like this, it falls. Why it falls? So why this spinning top falls itself? You know, you can explain. This is, say, for example, your vertical line. If you are able to mount to your spinning top, such that the center of gravity is exactly in the vertical line, no problem. It will remain stable in the vertical direction. Suppose you are not able to mount it vertically, you have put it now slightly tilted. So the spinning top, it's slightly tilted, I have exaggerated, you know, here the CG is there. So what happens is the weight is acting like this. So your pivot point is here, the support is here. So the weight will have a reaction here, that is W, and this is W. So it imparts a torque or a moment. So that torque gives a angular acceleration alpha like this. Then what happens is tilts little bit further, then the distance between these two increases further, the alpha then increases. So it falls much faster now. So it happens till it goes and touches the ground. So initially with lesser acceleration because less torque, then as it increases and tilts more, the torque is also increased. So more torque is now applied. So more torque means greater acceleration, means falls faster. So it goes and falls flat. So that is what it happens here. So when you take the gyro without spinning, you keep it, it falls. The spinning top without this, it falls. So you see the construction, there is a rotating wheel. Now I'll spin it before I'll see what is the effect of the spinning. So I have a small rack here. So now it is spun to a certain speed. You see, it's not falling. Does it fall? Or even if I tilt it, because the friction is not sufficient, But even if I tilt it, it's not falling much. Why it is not falling? So not only that, I can think of something, you know, some... It's not, you know, at staying itself in an inclined position, but it is rotating. So that is the precession. You have a spin and a precession. Without precession, it cannot be stable. So what is really happening here? Not only that, you can even make it to stand on a rope like this. It doesn't require a stable platform. Even on a rope, it can stand. Now, let me try to do that. I don't know whether somebody's help is required. I'll check. I'll try to do it. Okay. Someone can hold. Little loose. I have to show it to the... Yeah, you come here. Look at the video. Yeah, yeah, just rope. Yeah. Now I'll spin it. Now I will keep it over here. A little bit of stretching. Not too flexible. Not too tight or not... Neither too tight. A little bit, stretch it a little bit. Yeah, you can show. You can walk, no problem. So even on this, it is stable. Okay? So there are some funny things you can see that one gyroscope over the other like it, all these things, if you spin it at sufficiently high speed, it will be stable enough. So thanks for this the presentation, because I would not have this. This is incidentally purchased at MIT, US, presented by your the outgoing senior Vaishnavi. Vaishnavi got admission in MIT for her PhD program. So one day she came that and presented this toy, gyro, got in MIT. This book is also from MIT. So no problem, I'm taking that stuff which is there from MIT. Okay. So this spinning top and all this, what is the basic? We will have a PowerPoint presentation now, so you can just have a pause for it. Okay, quick look at that gimbal again. In the case of inertial guidance or navigation, this is your wheel and there is a frame, first frame, and there is a second frame. You can see the three bearings in axis, perpendicular axis, one perpendicular, another one, this one. So you will not be, torque cannot be transmitted through that. This is a rate gyro to measure the angular velocities at three different axes. So maybe it could be a missile where you have to measure the angular velocities in three axes. So you integrate it, you get what is the angular rotations. So that you want to fix the, if you have fixed the target, it will correct itself. There must be a control system to correct it. So three axes, that is the rate gyro. That is a simplified diagram, but this is could be the actual, the thing which has a more complex parts inside. Some of the gyros are meant to work for few minutes, because when I launch the missile, its task is over in few minutes. So the gyro will not be spinning inside. So what we normally is there is a gyroscopic attachment, and suddenly when the missile is fired, a jet of air or a gas will impinge on the gyroscopic rotor, and that makes this rotor to spin, and that will act as your gyroscope. It will work for a few minutes till the missile goes and strikes the target. So missile means it is not simply a missile with explosive. It requires the guidance systems as well. So that's why it's quite expensive. So these are the things we already seen, that the commercial aircraft will have a gyro which can sense the one rotation in 300 years. But lunar landing, Apollo mission had one rotation in 30,000 years. But it's all being replaced because gyros are very, very expensive stuff. So that was all replaced by GPS systems. So now a military grade GPS system will do that, no spinning wheel, but still you are able to do that. So we have seen already the MEMS gyro, which are mounted in your cell phones, available for $2 to $3, can do this function little bit. Okay, the angular velocity rate gyro function can be done by that. So this is a stabilizer, we will discuss the next class. Something about the definition or discussion of spin or orbital motions. You have to have a clear distinction of between these two motions. If you can think of a rigid body is, you know, rotating about an axis which is passing through its center of mass, then it is called the spin. An orbital motion is the motion of the center of mass itself. Okay, so center of mass of this itself is moving in a reference frame with respect to origin. You can say it is having an orbital motion. The earth spins about an axis passing through the CG. The angular velocity of this is, you know, one rotation per 24 hours. So that happens, we calculated it 7.3 into 10 to the power of minus 5 radians per second. But apart from that, the earth itself, the center of mass of the earth itself is having a motion that is called the orbital motion. So that orbital motion is happening in an angular velocity of 1.99 to 10 to the power of minus 7 radians per second. That is, it completes one motion in 365 days. The center of mass, that orbital motion, need not be in a circular path. It can have different paths as well. Don't think that it should have a circular path. In a centrifuge, it is having a circular path. But when it is a planetary motion, the earth is having following an elliptical path. The center of mass of the earth is undergoing an elliptical motion path. And if a ball which is spinning, it is kicked, the spinning ball, when it moves, it can even go in a straight line to reach the goal post. Or this some kind of a system where it need not be a closed loop itself. So spinning means it has to be rotating about an axis, but orbital motion path need not be following a closed loop, or it should be a circular. It can be elliptical path as well. So this is what, if you look at the spinning top, you can think of a vertical axis, and this is your CG of the spinning top. The weight is acting like this. The reaction from this, you know, where it is touching, it is going to be in the vertical direction. So these two are going to create a couple. So that is responsible for tilting. When the spinning top is not rotating, this is going to fall. That is obvious. This is what it is going to fall. The rate at which it fall will increase because the instantaneous torque or couple is going to increase. Now it is about the spinning top. But please note down this word, that is a rapidly spinning top. So why it should be rapidly spinning top? Because then only the analysis will be simple. So this rapidly spinning top means this angular momentum vector of the spin will be much higher. So this is the angular momentum vector like this. So why it presses? What causes the spinning top to process, you look at it, the weight is acting downwards here, here, that introduces a couple. So that couple will be perpendicular to this plane at this instant. That will make this angular momentum vector to turn like this. That causes the precession. So precession direction is will be different if the spinning wheel is now turning from looking from the top, it is rotating in the anti-clockwise direction. Suppose this, you change the direction of spin to rotate in the clockwise direction, the angular momentum vector will be going inwards. For the same torque, it will process in the opposite direction. Okay? So that is what it is, a gyroscope, because by definition, you know, any object where there is a facility to provision to change the axis, spinning axis, then it is a gyroscope. Here, it is a gyroscope. You have the torque is applied, it has an angular momentum, torque is applied, it presses. But when it presses, it has a rotation about this vertical axis. So if you think of the moment of inertia of this particular top about this axis, that has an angular momentum in this direction as well. Don't think that only one angular momentum. This is the spin angular momentum. But this object, this spinning top, as it turns, so with respect to the axis, you can think of the moment of inertia. It has the omega, the p. So it will have its the precession angular momentum. So you have to take into account of both the momentums to find out the net effect. To simplify it, we assume that this momentum, the precession angular momentum, is negligible compared to this. That is why this is carefully worded like it is rapidly spinning. We also made an assumption in the simplified gyroscope that the spin omega s is much larger than omega p. So that is makes, otherwise slowing spinning top is very difficult to, you know, calculate or discuss. Okay, you have to think of the angular momentum on both directions, you have to take that effect. Because you know that as it falls, the moment of inertia also is going to be a variable. Okay, then the angular momentum of the spin or the precession also will be increasing. So those things we have to take simultaneously. That will be a great exercise to do. Now about the earth. About the earth, you know, it has both orbital motion as well as the spin motion. The earth, your school teacher would have said that it is not a spherical shape, it is an ellipsoid shape. Make you to draw that in a, like an ellipse, but it is not an ellipse to large extent, because if you take the radius at the equator, it is 6,378 kilometers. The difference in the radius of the polar to this thing is only just 22 kilometer. So if you take the ratio of this, the 22 by this, it's a very, very, very negligible. You can just draw a circle and say that it is slightly ellipsoid. So practically speaking, it is only a spherical thing, but there is a small eccentricity is there. It is an ellipsoid. So it is an oblate ellipsoid. By rotating the minor axis, you get it. So that is the shape of the earth. So practical purposes, just 22 kilometers out of 6,000 is nearly, you can say, it is a spherical one. Okay. So this is what happens. So your earth is there, it is going to spin. So it will have an angular momentum. Even though it spins at a very slow speed, the moment of inertia is so huge, then it has an angular momentum vector, it is shown like that. So it has an orbital motion, so it goes around the sun. Then the ellipse of this is also exaggerated, mostly because if you find out that the ratio of this distance when it is at solstice and the equinox, it's also the ratio will be 0.99 something. That small difference makes in our weather to the extreme of the winter and the summer. Okay, it's very small change in the distance. The ratios are very, very small. And now it goes around like this. The earth spins around like that. The angular momentum at any instant, it is going to be parallel. So I don't, the magnitude is going to be same. Direction is also conserved. So I don't require a torque in this direction to do this. Okay. So that is what it happens. It goes around and it is tilted by an angle of 23.5 degree to the vertical. Okay. How this gyroscope stuff comes, we are not discussing about that particular thing now. It is just having a motion like this. But this 23.5 degree angle it makes with the vertical is going to precess. It is undergoing a precession. Earth is a rotating system. It rotates. It has an angular momentum. When a torque is acting on it in a perpendicular direction, it will precess. What creates the torque? That is important. What creates the torque is, like, you have to carefully observe, there is in the equator slightly 22 kilometer bulging is there with respect to the radius. It's a small bulging is there. So this part of the bulging is nearer to the sun compared to this part of the bulging. So according to the gravitational law, it's the inverse R square. So this will have a greater force than this. So with respect to the center of gravity, you have a greater force. That is your torque. That is going to act in this direction. That causes the earth to precess. If it is a spherical thing, then this will not happen. If this is not tilted, no torque will be there. It is, since the earth is tilted by 23.5 degree, one is nearer than this, and that too, this force is away from the center of mass creating. So this force is slightly larger than this. That causes the torque that makes the earth to precess. The precession rate is very, very small. What is the precession rate of this? The people have calculated it. It is 25,785 years. One precession like this will take 25,000 years approximately. You and I may not live to experience the total precession, but precession occurs. Okay? So, what to say is, the earth is a huge gyroscope, not by simple means, but because of the various factors, like it is not spherical. It is, even if it is not spherical, it doesn't matter. If the spinning axis is vertical, or spinning axis is perpendicular to this plane, or called orbital plane, this would not have occurred. It is tilted by 23.5 degrees. So that causes a small torque, very small torque. That's why the precession rate is so small, something like 25,000 years. One rotation in 25,000 years. Okay, such a small precession rate. So Earth itself is a gyro. Your spinning top is a gyro. Okay, so all of them comes under these. Any doubts? So this is pure physics, but I have thought this thing because sometimes it may be useful to exploit the situation. You can remember now, connected with the gyro used in Apollo mission was something like 30,000 years. Here the precession rate is 25,000 years, like that. The precession rate of such things are very small. So still you should be able to deduct it. So we require an extremely precise gyro. Okay. So we will close with this, close with this, close with this, close with this.